Hello my friends, welcome to my Energy Economist channel. We're gonna talk today about the theory of oil rent and ownership of the oil reserves. So stay with me. The phenomenon of economic rent as a category distinguished from normal profits is neither original to Marx nor specific to classical political economy. However, what made Marx's theory of agricultural rent different from his predecessors' theories is the specificity of the analysis itself, not the category. The notion of oil rent in the oil industry is none other than the phenomenal form of the specific property relation that is unique to the oil industry. Historically, the separation of the ownership of hydrocarbon deposits from the ownership of the oil fields resulted in the emergence of this barrier within the accumulation process in the production of oil. In countries or regions where the ownership of the surface oil legally includes the subsoil, the owners of particular oil leases, that is, capitalist producers, are confronted with the obstacle of ownership of the oil deposits. This relationship remains the same even if the state as a legal institutional form of landed property owns the oil lands, owing to the establishment of capitalist institutions. The separation of ownership is part of a historical process that is realized legally through the act of lease contracts, concessions, etc. At the same time, theoretically, capital investments made by the owners of the subsoil are also subsumed under the separation of ownership of the subsoil from ownership of land. The owner of the land comes to appropriate rent, while the capitalist investor tends to appropriate normal profit. It's critical to note that the oil concessions in the Middle East and elsewhere in the world had been formed and framed to span nearly some 6 years of duration, a lengthy lease nevertheless. These leases were signed into de facto contracts that for whatever reason renewed from time to time. In fact, there had been frequent modifications and adjustments in these concessions. For example, the revision of the original Darcy concession 1901 and the adoption of a modified version in the 1933 concession. Between the Iranian government and the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company is a case in point. Hence, there are simply no ifs and or buts in the issue of who owns oil reserves in the ground. Yet, Daniel Yergin believes that the concessionaires, i.e. leaseholders within the IPC, owned the reserves in all the member countries with the exception of Iran. The oil reserves in the ground actually belonged by contract to the concessionaires, the companies, thus limiting the country's control. A study that was completed in the early 1970s concluded that there is a major distortion in the exploration of oil that primarily resulted from a widely divided ownership of land in the United States. This situation stems from the fact that the oil fields are often larger than the corresponding U.S. oil leases that belong to the firm that made the discovery. The result is that the full benefits will rarely go to the primary discoverer. To substantiate this point, Miller goes into a long discussion of the extent of a fragmentation of oil leases through the examination of portions of profits received by the main discoverer of the field. As a first approximation, He uses the production share of the largest producer of a field as a proxy of the firm's profit share. From this empirical work, it was discovered that the percentage of the benefits from a well received by the discoverer declines with the size of the field. Consequently, the barrier of fragmentation of the pattern of land ownership tends to move the capitalist investors away from engagement in new and larger oil fields that often require the assembling of large tracts of land barrier to exploration. Another problem is the fragmentation of oil leases in connection with secondary and tertiary recovery methods, where the whole field needs to be put under the control of a single management to eliminate waste and enhance the productivity of the extraction process. This is called unitization. It would seem obvious that having a number of leases in a particular oil field undoubtedly works against production according to a predetermined schedule. The intensification of capital investments within the existing oil fields is by and large the consequence of the embedment of the prevailing pattern of land and lease ownership in the US oil production. The structure of landed property and the fragmentation of oil leases played an influential role in the direction of capital investments. And the structure of accumulation in the US oil industry long before the oil crisis of 1973-74. That set a new basis for the formation of market values, rents, and market prices at the global level. The internationalization of oil production is the manifestation of this process at the global level. During the early period in the oil industry in the Middle East and elsewhere, essentially outside the geographical boundaries of the United States, the production of oil was through the colonial contracts and in the parlance of political economy, originated the rudimentary introduction of capitalism and thus formal subsumption of labor. However, as the material foundation of capitalism in these social formations and also within the international oil industry has further developed, the production of oil had gradually assumed the characteristic of the real subsumption of labor under capital at the global level. In consequence, a social value at the global level has emerged that systematically intertwined with the formation of differential oil rents through global competition. Therefore, from the theoretical standpoint, it may not be difficult to appreciate why general application of Ricardo's specific margin prevalent in today's mainstream theory is not a fruitful method in the analysis of petroleum or possibly any other industries. At the empirical level, we are able to identify the US oil fields as the least productive region of the world. The US oil fields are also the most explored oil region of the globe. Due to the integration of oil production at the global level and the fact that US oil comes from the least productive oil fields, the social value associated with the above oil fields has become the social value of the entire international oil industry. Thus, it is through the decline in the productivity of the old US oil fields located in the lower 48 states in the 1970s that the magnitude of the newly formed social value has been restructured simultaneously with the reorganization of the entire oil industry through the crisis. If you want to learn more about the theory of oil rent and ownership of the oil reserves, you could do so in my book, Economic Study of Oil and Gas Exploration, which is published on Amazon. Check it out at the link in the description. Please take a second to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and don't forget to also hit the notification bell. Thank you for watching and goodbye.